Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Fiendish Midlife by Leah Davis and L.A. Boruff. Narrated by Coleen Marlo. Chapter 1. Lucifer. The Cat, Not the Devil.
I guess I'm sorry I haven't been in to see you. I paused and studied Alfred's prone form on the bed. He was so still that if I hadn't noticed his chest rising and falling, I'd have dismissed him as being dead. Hell, he wasn't undead anymore, whatever that meant. To be frank, I've only just missed you today. With a sniff, I inspected my right foot. The first claw there felt like it was loosening. Ugh, so annoying. I'd asked Ava several times to schedule someone to come give me pedicures, but each time I'd asked, she'd shaken her head and rolled her eyes, as if I were amusing to her. Pfft, she didn't know the struggle. Besides, there were plenty of cat owners who gave their cats pedis. Ava said you'd been in here since November. I nibbled at the loose claw and considered the date. I think we're in March now, so it's not like you've been missing all that long. Ava was so dramatic sometimes, seriously. 4 months? That's nothing. How am I supposed to keep track of everyone all the time, anyway? Alfred didn't respond, which I tried to ignore. It wasn't exactly fair to be annoyed at a sleeping man, even if I was halfway sure he was a big fat faker. Seriously, if he needed a vacation from all of Ava's craziness, he just had to say so. See, I'm a good cat. I do try to be nice, and at least 20% of the time, I succeed. Maybe 15. For a cat, that's excellent, right? It doesn't really matter if you think it's excellent or not. I think it is, and my opinion is the one that matters. Anyway, it's been such a boring few months since you've been snoozing away up here. The man named after me, Luci, with an I, has been running around like a maniac. I've never seen him look so frazzled and, ugh, sweaty. It had been disgusting. I mean, come on, was it too much to ask to blot his ugly, hairless face once in a while? Maybe take one of those water baths humans were so attached to? Alfred didn't even snore in response, but that was okay. When I spoke, people listened. No doubt he was processing and absorbing my words. A muffled sound, like a grunt or something, came from somewhere in the room. I paused in the grooming of my tail and listened. Is someone in here? With a long stretch, I stood and cocked my head to hear better. Hello? It almost sounded like someone was whispering to me. Am I on camera? If someone was pranking me, I'd scratch their face off. The volume of the whispering increased. I squinted as if that could help me hear better, and Alfred's voice differentiated itself from the whispers.
Tell Ava it's the...
It faded out. I knew it was him because he sounded like a squirrel on helium, even from wherever he was talking to me. What? I yelled. Alfred, is that you? Why are you whispering? Can't you speak up? Just wake up for fu...
Shut up!
He whisper yelled. How rude.
Tell Ava it's the necromancers!
Okay, okay, you don't have to be so rude about it. Jeez. I hopped off the side of his bed. Anything else, Your Majesty? The whispers had disappeared along with Alfred's annoying high-pitched voice. What a whiner. I strolled out of his bedroom and down the hall. Hey, Luci, Ava said as she passed me going toward Alfred's room. With a massive sigh, I replied, Hey. Ugh, why did she always have to talk to me? Was talking that important? At the top of the stairs, something bugged me, so I looked back at Ava in time to see her enter Alfred's room. Seemed like there was something I was supposed to have told her. Oh well.
Chapter 2. Ava. Alfred? I whispered near his ear right before placing a soft kiss on his forehead. I'm so sorry it took me so long to get up here. I hate leaving you alone in here. although he wasn't really ever alone for long, because Winnie refused to leave his side unless one of us made her take a break. Sitting on the rocking chair beside the bed, I glanced over at Alfred's still form.
"I trust you won't rat me out to Winnie," I snorted. But then the snort nearly turned into tears.
"I'm sorry. I want more than anything to get you up and about. I hope you know that."
He didn't respond, but I hadn't expected him to. "I doubt you can even hear me, but on the off chance you can, I want to keep you up to date on our lives." Not that they'd been particularly riveting over the last 4 months. Once Alfred conked out, we'd pretty much gone on hiatus, spending all our spare time trying to find a cure for him or trying to help Luci with his little problem of being locked out of hell. Trying being the operative word here. Nothing had worked. I was beginning to think that there was a bigger issue at work. What that could be, I hadn't a clue. Luci still hasn't come back. I pulled a blanket over my lap and grabbed my latest release. I'd actually had time to finish it in between the failures of helping Alfred and Luci. He's so freaked out. He'd been MIA for a couple of weeks now. Olivia was getting really worried. Rocking the chair, I tried to remember the last thing I'd told Alfred. "Did I tell you Luci got this little statue from a shaman in the Amazon? He's been carrying it around like a security blanket." He had been the last time I'd seen him anyway. I rolled my eyes and laughed. The last time I saw him, it was tied around his neck, but he either didn't want to try or couldn't get a hole in it. So he'd woven a leather string thing around it, then tied it around his neck. It looked ridiculous. I'm still trying to figure out if he was actually trying to channel the shaman's magic or being a weirdo. I snorted again. Anyway, none of that matters right now. I stopped the rocking chair and grabbed Alfred's hand. It was cold, but I held it anyway. What mattered was that we'd hit a dead end in helping him. We'd tried everything we could think of and everything anyone we knew could think of. I didn't want to tell him that, so I said that Winnie's coming up in a few minutes. I made her take a long lunch and an hour's nap. Setting his chilly hand back on the blanket, I tried for the 1,000th time to heal him. For the 1,000th time, it didn't work. Yeah, okay, so I was trying to think of something to tell him that I hadn't said, probably twice already, when Winnie stuck her head in the door. A flash of pain crossed her face when she saw Alfred. She'd been completely, utterly wretched the last 4 months without Alfred.
"Hey,"
she called, her voice soft and sad.
"Just letting you know I'm grabbing a sandwich, then I'll be in here."
"Take your time," I waved my novel at her. "I haven't even started reading it." She nodded once, then ducked out. I sighed and got myself together before I tried to read, taking a moment to make sure my voice wouldn't shake. Chapter 3. I read loudly and steadily and made it through the chapter without looking at one of my favorite people in the whole world and what amounted to a coma beside me. When I turned the page to Chapter 4, I glanced up to find Drew leaning against the doorway. "Hey, you." I smiled as he walked toward me. My breath caught as I drank him in. How did I get lucky twice in a lifetime in the husband department? I was focusing so hard on the chapter and on not crying. I didn't hear or feel you come up. We were bonded, which meant I generally knew where he was at all times. It wasn't an exact science, but it sure was handy to see whether he was safe or not. As an officer's wife, worry was my job while he was busy at his.
"It's a good chapter," Drew said, sitting in the second chair we'd brought in weeks ago. His presence was like a tiny wave of calm in this storm.
I smiled at him, then back at Alfred. "It's taking too long." Drew reached over and put his hand on my knee.
"We don't need to talk about that now."
He was right, of course, but I was upset and growing more so every single day.
"I do have some news."
The smile on his face made me hopeful for a distraction. "Oh, yeah?" He rocked his chair and squinted at me.
"Ian's coming."
His words had said good news, but his tone now said dread and woe. "Why doesn't that sound like you're happy about it?"
No, I am, of course. I'm the one who invited him here."
He needed to inform his face of said happiness.
This is about the job opening. Not a visit? Oh, there went his face again. Yes, he, Drew sighed. He says he's getting tired of the instability of the hunter lifestyle. He wants to settle in one place like Lily did.
Drew's sister Lily had taken a permanent hunter job in Florida, kind of close to her step-grandchildren.
To my great luck, Drew had retired here to Shipton Harbor many years ago. He still took the occasional hunter job when they really needed him, but they were few and far between. Why here? I asked, and stood to retuck Alfred's blankets around him. My constant healings had kept him from wasting away here in the bed, even though they did absolutely nothing toward waking him up. Even so, Winnie did exercises with him 3 or 4 times a day, keeping his body moving. She didn't want him to get sore lying there in the bed. After all, he was completely human now, so he had to worry about blood clots and stuff like that.
I guess because I invited him.
Drew helped me, lifting Alfred so I could fluff the pillows under him. We adjusted him slightly on one side rather than flat on his back, using a few spare pillows. I'm glad, I said, smiling at Drew when we were done. It'll be great for you to have your brother here. Drew grimaced a smile that brought a giggle to my lips. What's that face about?
I love my brother. You know I do.
After I folded the blanket that had been on my lap, we settled back in our rocking chairs. I do know.
The thing is, Ian and I work best in small doses. The occasional hunt, sometimes hanging out. That's how we're at our absolute top brotherly shape.
I could understand that, sort of. I didn't really have anyone in my life like that, but I can imagine. If he lives here full time, you're afraid you'll get sick of each other?
He shrugged. It's not forever. Once he's fully trained at the police department, I can focus on retiring and leave him to it.
That is a good point. I grabbed his hand and grinned. After that, you can drive me crazy.
He squeezed my fingers. That's the goal.
You feel good about Ian being voted in as sheriff? I asked.
He nodded and shrugged at the same time.
He's definitely competent. And now that Sam's a vampire, there's nobody else who is the right age or has the right qualifications. Or who isn't an idiot.
I chuckled as I imagined the deputy who had prompted that statement. The poor man was a bit more Barney Fife than Andy Griffith. A total sweetheart, but not so much in the common sense department. Drew stood and leaned over me, caging me in my chair. A spark of desire fluttered through my insides.
Sorry, my love. I have to go to work. Ian isn't here and working yet.
Which means you're still pulling extra shifts. I sighed and held my face up for his smooch. I'll miss you.
You too,
he whispered.
Oh, Alfred, I said softly once Drew left. Would you please just wake up?
I stared at him for a few seconds before a loud noise outside the door pulled me from my seat.
I'm going to kill you!
Oh, that was Zoe's voice, and she only ever got that tone when she was furious with Lucifer, our sassy white cat. I opened the door in time to see a streak of white go by. Luci. Quickly behind her came Zoe, my 19-year-old semi-adopted tiger shifter ghoul daughter. Her boyfriend and my semi-adopted ghoul son, Larry, hurried soon after, holding on to his head. He was fully fleshed out, but his head never had properly reattached when I'd accidentally animated him. He'd been a skeleton back then, and his head had an unfortunate habit of falling off. It couldn't fall off now that he was fully human-looking again, with skin and all, but it did like to flop over on him. It was disturbing.
Puke on the bed, he called.
Ew, not again. Luci really had to stop doing that. I turned to the right to watch him run down the stairs after the two cats and found Winnie pressed against the wall, waiting for the chaos to pass before she came into the room. She came in with a big ball of yarn and a partially knitted something in a big canvas bag. Blanket? I nodded toward the bag.
Scarf.
For who?
Winston.
She said it so matter-of-factly that I nearly accepted her words at face value.
Winston the house? I asked.
She rolled her eyes.
It's a blanket, Ava. I thought you sold all those books because they were funny.
Huh. I was funny, thanks very much. You're cranky. She shot me an apologetic glance.
Sorry, I am cranky. I miss Alfred.
I squeezed her shoulder. I know you do. My phone pinged from my back pocket with Olivia's custom tone. And I'm so sorry, but I have to go. She waved me off.
Go. Me and Alfie have catching up to do. I haven't talked to him in several hours.
At the door, I looked back at my aunt. She looked completely different from how she'd looked as I grew up, but that was because she had a brand new body, one with spectacular boobs. Over the last 4 months, she hadn't flaunted them, not once. Even now, she wore an oversized sweatshirt. She'd lost interest in her excitement of her new body. Who would have thought that would be disappointing? Chapter 3. Olivia. Hello?
Ava's voice floated up the stairs from the foyer of Luci's house. Oh, good. I'd been hoping she'd get here sooner than later.
Coming!
I rushed out of my bedroom and grabbed the bag full of notes and things I'd been accumulating to take to the school.
Coming! Coming!
Descending the stairs, I watched every step because it didn't matter how many stairs I'd come down successfully. That one time I'd fallen down the stairs at school, bouncing like a freaking bouncy ball ass over tea kettle, was the only thing that stuck in my head. Once safely at the bottom of the stairs, I ran through the living room and down the hall that seemed longer than it had yesterday. And why wouldn't it? The house was nuts. Finally, I burst into the kitchen to find my best friend Ava looking at a nasty burn on my biological father's arm. My father, Lucifer.
What are you, new here?
My dad is the devil. Move on.
Where have you been?
I fixed Luci with a glare and marched forward to put my stuff down on the table, then round it and snatch his arm out of Ava's hands.
Why are you hurt? I didn't even realize you could get hurt like this.
To be completely honest, I didn't have the foggiest clue what would or would not hurt the man. Any time I attempted to bring the subject up, or anything else personal, he got cagey and changed the subject.
Not suspicious at all.
It was my own dumb fault.
Ava pulled his arm back and worked her magic to heal it.
You're lucky I can do this, she muttered. My magic still isn't working right.
Luci studied her as she bent over his arm.
Indeed, I still can't see why. If I weren't so focused on getting back into my domain, I might be able to figure it out.
She glanced up at him and he smiled fondly down at her. Aw, my dad liked my bestie. How sweet. Another way to look at it? The devil was fond of his necromancer. Potato, potato.
How did you say this happened?
I asked pointedly. And more importantly, where in the world have you been?
Oh, that. I found a weakness in the barrier between here and hell and tried to exploit it.
I see that worked out really well for you, I said dryly. With a wink, he continued.
As for where I've been, you know where. I've been trying to get through the barrier. I spent a week or so trying to bribe Cerberus, but he's too well trained.
He rolled his eyes.
He should be. I trained him myself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.